Hey, everybody, and welcome to the Dark Matter Knits podcast. This is episode 22, Design On with Confidence. I'm Elizabeth Green Musselman. It's December 19th, 2014. Hello. So today, what I want to talk to you about is the core of it is essentially about a very frustrating designing experience that I had this week. And a wonderful new book about knitting design, and particularly for people who are getting started in knitting design, that will hopefully help you avoid some of the pitfalls that I have tripped over repeatedly in my own self-taught entry into the world of knitting design. So before we get started with all of that, I have some little announcement-y type things to take care of. First of all, we have a few giveaways from last time. There were supposed to be three, and perhaps because there were so many, I kind of lost track. So I put up two of the giveaway threads in the Ravelry forum immediately, and then I realized later that I had neglected to put up the third. So I am leaving the Mzansi South Africa on My Needles giveaway thread open for another couple of weeks, because that's the one that I neglected to put up until really about a week in past the episode coming out. So I want to give that one a little more time to be open, since it wasn't open right away. And then the other two I have drawn for, so let's go ahead and do that. The first one was for one of these lovely hand-thrown dishes that looks like it's knitted by Charon Sechar. And this is mine. The one that you are going to be receiving is a beautiful sage green color. So the winner of that was number 57, Betty for Fiber. And you need to, Betty, please get in touch with me by emailing me directly at darkmatterknits@gmail.com, or you can message me on Ravelry. I'm darkmatterknits there. And just send me your full name and your mailing address, and I will get out to you as soon as I can. And the second winner is of the Triple Swell Hat Pattern by Lucia Payne, the lovely Pearl of the Pacific. And that winner is number 21, Mathlete07. And I've already messaged Lucia to let her know that you're the winner of the pattern. So you should be receiving that in your Ravelry library very soon. So thanks to everybody who entered. I always love asking weird questions in these giveaways because I love reading your answers. So let me read you the one that Mathlete07 posted, because the question for that was particularly fun. Let me find her here. Okay, here she is. So her actual name is Catherine. She's from St. Louis. So the question I asked was, because Lucia's pattern was inspired by where she liked to play when she was a kid, so I asked you about where you liked to play when you were a kid. She said, "I love to play in the alley with the neighborhood kids, from riding bikes to cops and robbers. We always had something fun going on. I'm thankful to have grown up before cell phones in a neighborhood safe enough to be told to be home by 5 and don't cross X, Y, and Z streets." It's totally my childhood too. All right, so those were the giveaways from last time. I actually have a new one for this week, in addition to leaving the giveaway open for Mzansi, the book that I reviewed last week. Alan LoCicero, who is the designer of this lovely pattern that you may recall me knitting. It's a little rumpled up because I have been wearing this constantly because I love it. So this is the pesto lace shawl pattern. It is not only rumpled up, but it has a ton of my hair in it. Oh, I'm like a cat lady with no cats. So this is the important bit. Such a lovely lace edging on this, knit with my October House Fiber Arts yarn, and really liked this combination, she said, as she picked more hair out of her shawlette. So anyways, I'm starting to get like the fat squirrel here, who just slays me every time. just watching her this morning and rolling on the floor laughing. Anyways, Alan Lo Cicero has very kindly offered to send one person a copy of this pattern as a gift. And so I'm going to open a thread on Ravelry and just ask you to go look at her patterns and tell me if you were going to knit another one of her patterns to wear with the shawl, which one would you make? So I will post that in the Ravelry group as a thread, and you can enter there. And it's all the usual rules. You need to be a member of the group to win, and just one entry per person. And don't chat in the thread because it makes it easier for me to draw if there's, just one post per person. I also wanted to point out, while we're talking about giveaways, that Charon, who's the potter, contacted me and said that he really wanted to thank you all for visiting his site and for buying so many of his things. Apparently, you all really, really love his pottery just as much as I do. And a lot of his pottery went out the door to some of you. So thank you for supporting handcrafted goods for the holidays. Much appreciated. And I should note, I don't think they're up on his site yet, but I'm on his mailing list, and he said that he is about to start producing. He also said this in our group on Ravelry, on the Dark Matter Knits group, that he is about to start selling mugs with the knitted print on them. They're so cute too. They have little rivets down, like right near the handle, so it looks like you've got a buttoned-up knitted cardigan on your mug. I know. It's too much. Too much. So, that's the world of handcrafted goodness for you. I also, while we're in the world of seriously, how cute are people? I got an email. Actually, it was a Twitter private message, direct message from Joshua Sims, who said that his wife was a big fan of my podcast, and could I please say happy birthday to her on my podcast? Of course, I will say happy birthday to your wife on my podcast. Oh, so sweet. So, Penny, happy birthday. I can't, he told me when I think your birthday was a couple of days ago. Happy belated birthday. Seriously, it's starting to get all Today Show up in here. I thought that was so nice that he did that. Oh, people are lovely, aren't they? Okay, I believe that is all my announcementy goodness. What I have been knitting this week. I feel like my constant refrain is, seriously, I've been knitting, but it's gone. But that's how it is at this time of year, right? Especially when you record every 2 weeks. I had to mail off a bunch of stuff, obviously, for the holidays. And I had made a hat for my sister and a pair of mitts for my brother-in-law. They are now gone in the mail, winging their way to Philadelphia. If you watch QVC at all, you may know my sister from the In the Kitchen with David. In the Kitchen with David is the show that she used to be the associate producer on, and now she is effectively the co-host of. She does the social media, checks in with Facebook and helps him taste things. She has a great job, and she does a great job at it. Her name is Mary. So watch for her, and maybe she'll wear my hat. If she's watching this, maybe she'll wear my hat. Meaningful eyebrow. Maniacal laugh. And my brother-in-law, her husband, is a huge fan, very knit-worthy, because he is also a hand crafter. He makes watch bands out of recycled leather. And the coolest ones he's made so far, where he's taken old baseball mitts and made watch bands out of them. As soon as he has a really up and running shop, I will link to it because they are wicked cool. In fact, he may have. I will check to see, writing this down. I will check to see if he has got a shop going on Etsy yet. So those I knit, I do have photographs of them, so I will put them up on the blog post with the show notes at darkmatterknits.com, so you can find them there. The other thing I have, or other things I have been knitting, and one of them I have actually finished, is one of them is this hat, which I made for my husband for Christmas. He knows he's getting it already. I love this hat. I wrote up this design, and I will be publishing it soon. I think I'm going to call this the aftershave hat because my husband shaves his head. He is quite hairless on top, and so he just goes the full nine yards and shaves it all. And it looks very good on him. But his head gets really cold, even though it's not that cold here. So I've made him lots of hats, and this one, dude, you guys, this yarn, I made it out of this Bijou Basin Ranch Lhasa Wilderness. So the company is Bijou Basin Ranch. That's them. And they make this, can you see, yak down and bamboo blend. So here's the story. It's called Lhasa Wilderness, the blend, the name of the yarn is this. So remember when I reviewed this yarn? The green stuff that is 100% yak down, and I loved it. And I said offhand, here are some of the other bases they have. I'm gonna have to knit with that yak bamboo blend sometime. Well, apparently the guy who owns Bijou Basin Ranch, Carl. Hi, Carl. If you're still watching. He watched that episode and was like, "Oh, sure, I'll pop one in the mail to you." Thank you. So I got my own skein. Oh my gosh, you guys. I love this even more. It is so soft and luscious. And it just, I think what I especially like about this, the bamboo adds a little extra bit of softness, but it also adds, because it takes the dye differently, it adds a whole different layer of complexity to the color. You can kind of see it here in the way it's very luminous. It gives it just a little bit of shine, but not enough that, like, this is supposed to be a men's hat. It's not so shiny that, I think most men would still wear this. It's actually showing up a little shinier on screen than it is in real life. But it's less that it's shiny and more that it's luminous in real life. So I wanted to do something with this that, that gave it a little texture and a little interest, but that it was basically a really simple kind of slouchy hat that would feel good even on a head that has been recently shaved, the aftershave hat. So that's what this is. And it is basically a very simple ribbing pattern. And then fully fashion decreases up at the top. I am going to release this pattern for free to people on my mailing list. Meaningful eyebrow. People on my mailing list in January. So if you would like to get a copy of this pattern and you aren't already a member of my mailing list, which I send out a monthly newsletter, go ahead. There will be a link in the show notes to do that. The URL is kind of too complicated to say out loud and have it be useful at all. But just go to the show notes at darkmatterknits.com. The link to my mailing list to sign up is there. I send out a monthly newsletter. In January, you'll get a copy of this pattern. And otherwise, I will just release it for my usual $5 accessory pattern price on Ravelry. So again, Carl, thank you so much for sending this to me. I really Lerve, this yarn. I looked it up. This retails for $29, by the way. So, and I got this hat. I tried to use as much as I could without getting too close to the end. This has 180 yards in it. It's a 2 ounce skein. So this used probably about 150 yards, perhaps. It's a sport weight. And so you could get a hat or a cowl out of one skein of this. And it's a really nice, you know, kind of luxury gift without having to spend too much. The other thing that I have been working on as my purse knitting are these, which you may recall from previous episodes, my Dark Side of the Moon mitts. So I have one done. Oh. I love these so much. I can't wait to wear them. I'm thinking about wearing just one of them because I love them so much. So not a pattern, just a winging it kind of thing. And again, wanted to use as much of this as possible. I think I ended up with Stacy splits. I'll talk more about the yarn in a second, but Stacy splits these into a full skein is split into perfect halves. So I had about this much left. And I basically wanted it to go almost all the way up to my elbow. And I made it so that the thumb and the palm can flip up and pretty much almost cover my fingers in case it gets chilly. And then when I want to use them, I can just flip those back. So kind of a fun way to use. I love this colorway so much that I didn't want to hide them under my pants. So this yarn, oh, and I'm this far into the second one. So I'm getting there. I'm almost, about two thirds of the way up the arm. So I finally found the tag so I can show it to you. Here it is. See if I can get this into a better position here. There we go. Mustache Yarns, Perfect Sock, Self-Striping. And this is one of her OCD colorways. And the idea behind that is that, as I say, it's a full skein. It's 400 yards split up into two 200-yard half skeins. And the color repeat starts in exactly the same place on the second skein as it does on the first, so that you can have perfectly matching socks or mitts or whatever. There are 468 yards in this, so quite generous yardage. And it's machine washable. It's a merino nylon blend. I love it. And I just want to say, I designed that logo. Isn't that cute? I love that. That's one of my favorite logos that I've done. So yeah, that's what I've been working on this week. I've been working on other stuff too, but it's stuff that I can't show you. So, sorry. I've also been doing a lot of computer work this week, as I often do. I do a lot of graphic design, as I may have mentioned before. And I am hurrying to get... I'm kind of wrapping up some work for Cooperative Press, some books that I had started and want to finish up. So I'm kind of in the thick of doing Defarge Does Shakespeare right now. If you're a fan of Craft Lit, you probably know that Heather Ordover has a series of books called What Would Madame Defarge Knit? And they're wonderful. The third one is the one I'm working on right now. I'm doing the book design and layout and a lot of the copy editing for it. And it's a big job because it's... Sorry. It's something like, it's almost 30 patterns and just contributed by different designers. So, you know, just getting it all into the right style sheet and, you know, getting everything consistent and correct and laid out and the photographs in and edited and... I'm really channeling the fat squirrel today. I think I watched her right before I started recording, so I'm kind of like, blah, blah. Stop drinking coffee. So, yes, that is the kind of rundown of the week. Let me just make sure. I have a bad habit of skipping things. No, that's it. All right. So into the heart of the matter. I want to talk a little bit about knitting design this week. I will probably often talk about knitting design, but it's been on my mind a lot this week because I got really, really, really frustrated this week. So I'm going to start with the frustrated part, and then I'm going to end on the good note with my review of Kate Atherley's Pattern Writing for Knit Designers, which is an excellent book. So let's start with the bad news. Okay, so I design a lot of sweaters, or I shouldn't say I design a lot of sweaters. I like to design sweaters. I have done a number of designs, and many of them have been sweaters, because I love sweater design. I think it is partly perversity, because sweater design is hard. It is really difficult to, because here's what happens, right? You don't make every single size of the sweater pattern that you're writing. You make one size. And then you have to figure out mathematically how the rest of the sizes are going to work themselves out in terms of numbers and instructions. So that seems fairly straightforward on its face, but there are a number of complications to it, including the fact that especially if you design for men, the information about men's sizing is scarcer than it is for women. It is available, but you have to pay for it and hunt it down. So that's one complication. Another one is that as soon as you change one variable, because this is a three-dimensional garment, right? As soon as you change one variable, all the others shift too. So, you know, if you tweak one number, you've got to pay attention to what that might do to the instructions and whether the stitch pattern is now off and how that changes the depth of the armhole, and it gets complicated fast. So this design, which I love, I did for Spud and Chloe, which I also love. I want to say that at the outset, because I'm going to do a lot of whining here, and I want to make clear this has nothing to do with Spud and Chloe. But it just so happens that I did the design for them. I love this pattern. It is a top-down saddle shoulder. I don't know why I'm tipping it forward, like, see his shoulders? See? See the top of him? If I turn him back, you can't. Well, it actually does kind of work, weirdly. Anyway, it's a saddle shoulder pattern. And I decided to figure out on my own how to do a top-down saddle shoulder, which was kind of fun, but also really difficult because, you know, trying to get the saddles built out and the yoke built up at the same time was an interesting three-dimensional puzzle. The part that ends up being really tricky, though, is this part right here. Really tricky in terms of getting the pattern right, because you got to get the increases just right, and you've got to build out. This is the part that really needs to fit the most, the shoulders and the upper yoke. So when I first sent in a draft of this pattern, the tech editor contacted me and said, I think the numbers that you've submitted make an armhole that is too long. And she explained her whole rationale, and I looked through it and I was like, I guess she's right. And I kind of looked at it and 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 looked at it. Rats. So we tried to figure out how to fix it, and it involved redoing the whole chart and redoing all the instructions for that part of the sweater. And I think we got it all worked out, and then we released the pattern, and about 6 months later, people started making it, right? I mean, they might have been making it earlier, but, you know, the notes started appearing on Ravelry and the questions. And the questions were all about that part of the pattern, and it's not working. Now, people had finished the sweater successfully a number of times, but I suspect they were more experienced knitters who knew how to just budget. As it turns out, I believe that both of them were, or one of them, was making the same size that I made, so I knew that one worked. The problems were coming with the other sizes. So I spent hours and hours fielding questions. I mean, it wasn't that many people, but just it was like three people, I think, who were sending me questions and struggling with the pattern. And each time it was a slightly different issue because they were different sizes and they were at different points. So I was trying to not just fix the pattern, but also help them get from where they were to a successful completion. And so I realize, right, there's something wrong. Like, this isn't just three people who got their stitch counts off. Like, there's something really off here. So I spent another several hours, 4 hours the other day, a couple of days ago, looking at the pattern again. And guess what? After refiguring and recalculating and looking at the chart and refiguring, first time. My chart was right originally. My numbers were right originally. I am 99% sure this is correct. I have sent all this back to the company and said, guess what? I'm pretty sure I was right the first time. And they are looking everything over and they've pulled the pattern so that we can get this all fixed up. And this stuff happens, right? Like, again, I want to make clear this isn't like I'm not complaining about Spud and Chloe. What I'm saying is, here's what I'm saying is that this is my takeaway message for myself is that I wish that I had had more confidence in the process, more confidence through the process in myself as a designer, because I think I let myself believe that the tech editor must be right and I must be wrong. Now, I will say that too much confidence can also be a dangerous thing. I have been on the other side of this equation where someone has insisted that they were right in the face of all logic and reason to the contrary. And insisted in a really snotty way. So that's not cool either. But yeah, I think I got myself a little confused, and I think I let myself believe that I couldn't possibly, that the tech editor must be right. And I don't think that she was. I mean, sometimes tech editors are wrong too, right? We are all fallible human beings. So it was very frustrating and very instructive to go through that whole process. I decided to have it that I was gonna buy gum. I was gonna have a positive takeaway message from all of this, and that is it that I need to design on with confidence. By the way, in case that's not clear, that is a not so subtle reference to Elizabeth Zimmermann, who famously said to knit on with confidence and hope through all crises. Elizabeth Zimmermann, if you don't know who I'm talking about, you gotta look her up. Two N's at the end. The grand matron of knitting in all the best senses. She's like the Maggie Smith of knitting. She is the Professor McGonagall of knitting. She was, well, she's no longer with us, but her books are still amazing, design-wise and essay-wise. Just, she's brilliant. I love her. So design on with confidence. I sometimes don't have a whole lot of confidence in myself as a designer. It's funny because, I have lectured people about having confidence in themselves as speakers and knitters. But yeah, sometimes I get a little squeamish about whether I can actually do this design thing or not. I gotta stop doing that. Segue into my review for this week of a delightful book. I only review delightful things. If it's not completely delightful, I will not review it. That's just how it goes. So this book, sorry, let me get this up on the screen here. This book is currently in ebook form only, although it will be released as a limited form, in a limited print run, in the new year. So if you would like a printed copy of this, you will need to get on it, purchase the digital copy soon, so that you can basically get on the list for a print copy. But the book is called Pattern Writing for Knit Designers. So I'm getting the cover up here for you. Pattern Writing for Knit Designers. The subtitle is Everything You Didn't Know You Needed to Know, A Helpful Guide by Kate Atherley. Now Kate, full disclosure, is a friend of mine. She is a knitting designer and tech editor who lives in Toronto, although I believe she is originally from the UK, and is the lead tech editor for Knitty. So, and she is one of the most clear-headed people I have come across. Very clear. And I have worked with her as a tech editor before, not on my own patterns, but for Cooperative Press. And I really enjoy working with her because she cuts right through the heart of the matter, and that is really evident in this book. She used to be has a degree in mathematics and has spent a previous part of her career as a technical writer. So you can really, she has long had a passion through teaching and writing and through editing for making knitting instructions clear. So she explains that in the first part of the book. So this book is designed to, it's not about everything about knitting design, but it is, like, 'cause there are lots of books that cover those aspects well. So there are books that talk about grading and, you know, the actual process of coming up with the numbers for designing a sweater, for example, or a pair of mitts or whatever. Lots of books on that. And she gives the titles and links to those and the resources. And there are a number of craftsy classes that talk about this. There are good books about the marketing of knitting patterns and craft in general. I think Market Yourself by Tara Swiger, for instance. So this book isn't that, but it does focus on pattern writing itself and making your patterns visually and linguistically, syntactically, the clearest they possibly can be. So let me show you the table of contents to give you some sense of what this covers. Oh, that's going to be way too small and blown out. So she talks, really the heart of the book, and to my mind, the most valuable portions of this book are chapters 1 and 2, which are called Pattern Structure and Elements and the Actual Knitting Instructions. And like I say, this is really the heart of the book. These are the longest chapters, and they are, I think, the most valuable contribution that this book makes to the knitting literature. Basically, she goes through and talks about what kind of elements need to be in a pattern, and why, and what you're trying to accomplish in each one of those sections of a pattern. So she goes through it step by step. The pattern name, I love that she actually takes time to talk about this, right? How to choose a good pattern name. It's not necessarily something that you would think is all that important. You might immediately move on to, you know, the numbers and the pattern notes and how you talk about repeats. But choosing a good pattern name is actually a really important part of having a successful pattern. It needs to communicate something about the inspiration or the aesthetic qualities of the design. And it's an important part of marketing the piece too. She talks a little bit about photography, although again, she readily admits this is not the focus of this book. There are lots of other good resources out there on that, and she gives them. She talks about writing a good introduction, why you might need a skills required section, what to put in there, how to how to give the right kind of information in your materials section. You know, she goes through every single aspect of the pattern and what you might want to include. So back to the pattern name thing. She gives such great examples in this book. It's not just she's got a very clear exposition style, but she also gives wonderful illustrative examples to show what she means. So one of my favorite examples comes in the choosing a pattern name section in chapter one. And she says that once she's saying, you know, you want to check different places to make sure that a name that you're choosing hasn't been used before or doesn't have weird associations. And she says one of the places you want to check your pattern name is Wikipedia, because once she was thinking about calling a lace scarf seasonal with an E on the end, and she found from checking Wikipedia that this is also the name of a brand of birth control pills. So maybe not the association you're going for. She has lots of oh, she talks about how it's a I thought this was a really good tip too, that it's a in your materials section, it's a good idea to describe your yarn's essential features for substitution purposes. So don't just give the name of the yarn and its fiber content and then later on give the gauge, but you know, maybe even include a little paragraph somewhere in the materials section or maybe the pattern notes about what the important features of the yarn are that are essential to the garment looking the way that it is. So, is it a really drapey yarn? Does it have a tight twist? Does it is the fact that it's solid important, solid colored? So I thought that was a really great tip and something that I hadn't quite thought about before. And then in chapter two, she goes on to talk about the nitty-gritty of actual knitting instructions, being clear, being consistent, being correct, how to ensure each of those things. And again, I think she gives really great suggestions about how to make your instructions as clear as possible, including tips about charts. And one of my favorite tips in there was that she recommended that for charts that are less than 24 stitches by 24 rows, just as a somewhat arbitrary marker, that you include written instructions. So if a chart is bigger than that, including written instructions just becomes way too cumbersome. But you know, if it's like a giant lace shawl, for example, having written instructions for every single line is just that's a nightmare for everyone, really. You just need to be able to read a chart if you're going to make a lace shawl that big. End of story. But if you've got a smaller chart, and she kind of draws the line at about 24 stitches by 24 rows or rounds, then include the written instructions. And it's not just because some people don't like charts. It's also that, and this is true for me too, that the written instructions can be a really good check with the chart. And in fact, I like the chart for the visual, but oftentimes, especially if it's a chart that has a lot of repeats in it, I like to chant it in my head, you know, knit three, yarn over, knit two together, knit three, SSK, yarn over, knit, you know. If it's enough that I can remember, I like to kind of chant it in my head. And it's a lot easier to do that if it's already written out and I don't have to translate it from the chart. There is a chapter on the actual making of charts, descriptions of different chart making software, tips for creating clear charts, for example, when and how to number the stitches along the bottom. There's a chapter on grading, which is pretty short because there are lots of other places that will tell you how to do that. There's even a chapter on formatting and layout, which I was especially appreciative of. Just, you know, how to format the pattern in such a way and lay it out that reinforces the clarity of the words and the charts. The process of bringing a pattern to market, so test knitting, tech editing, sample knitting, how to self-publish, what it's like to submit to a publication, how to submit a good proposal. And there's a chapter on selling online, how to list things on Ravelry, Patternfish, and Etsy, which are really the main places to list patterns. There's a chapter on copyright, which she had vetted by a copyright lawyer, which is extremely useful, and has some great information, including what is copyrightable and what isn't, which is a very important thing to understand. And there are a number of appendices at the end, which are incredibly useful. My favorite are the, well, they're all great. There are three of them. One of them is a pattern template. So it's not a pattern template in the sense that, you know, it's something that you can do layout into, but it's more the sections put in order and with prompts kind of asking you for different kinds of information so that you could use it to, as a kind of worksheet, to write up your own pattern. Awesome. And she also has that linked for free from her website so that you can use that at will. She has a set of standard abbreviations at the end that you can use, and a resources and bibliography section. It's an amazing book. It's about 156 pages. And like I say, it's currently in ebook form. It costs $25, and it is well worth the money if you are doing any kind of pattern writing at all. And I would say it is particularly valuable if you are relatively new to knitting design. Although I will say that I am very glad to have this. I'm very glad to have read it, and I'm very glad to have it in my library, even though I've been designing for probably about 10 years now. She said she's going to release a limited run of physical copies at a discount to people who have purchased the ebook. So if you are interested in that, probably best to send her an email or contact her through her website when you order the book and let her know that you're interested in a physical copy. Let me see what else. Oh, I wanted to show you the layout in here is really cool. Her friend and fellow knitting designer, She might be a dyer. I should have looked this up, sorry. Zabet. Let me get her last name up here. It is a very long list. Oh, it's not bad. Okay. Not bad for my incompetent Eastern European pronunciation. Zabet Groznaya, I believe would be how you'd pronounce that. Groznaya. So Zabet did the book and cover design. She did an excellent job. I bookmarked a place so that you could see. It would help if I knew how to work this program, wouldn't it? Aha! There it is. Okay, so she did this really cool book design. This is a busier page than most of them, but there's a lot of sidebars and quotes from knitters and knitting designers and magazine editors, all giving recommendations about what I like to see in knitting patterns, what I like to see in photographs, why it drives me nuts when pattern designers do this. So the quotes are all in those little comic quote bubbles there. And then there are tips on those, you know, cute little post-it note kind of things that look taped onto the page. So really fun layout and very easy to follow from one page to the next. And it really kind of having these little bits to break up the text gives you, it makes for very interesting reading. I found that I sat down and read this all in one fell swoop because it was so interesting. So really well written, nicely designed, excellent, excellent information, even if you've been designing for a while. And I thought it was interesting. She said why she wrote it was an interesting story. It's in the introduction. And she says that she's been teaching knitting for a long time and that she was really interested in looking at She teaches a class at her yarn store that where people can bring in whatever they're working on. There's a similar class at my own local yarn store, and I've subbed for it sometimes. People just bring in whatever they're working on, and the teacher helps them with it. And she's found in the process of teaching that class some really interesting patterns, if you will, in what trips people up in knitting patterns. And what are the good and bad elements of, or good and bad pattern design, what people struggle with. And she's found also from doing tech editing for Knitty some, similar kinds of patterns. So Knitty tends to take more new designers than a lot of other magazines. So the kinds of stuff that new pattern writers do, she's been kind of watching the trends and, what people might need help with when they're first getting started writing patterns. So, yeah, it's an excellent resource, and I would strongly recommend it if you are doing any kind of pattern writing or thinking about doing it, because it's going to be an essential part of your library. So that is Pattern Writing for Knit Designers by Kate Atherley, and the main place that you can find it is on her website, kateatherley.com, and she says it's also available on Patternfish and through Webs. So thank you, Kate, for sending me a copy of that book to review. I really appreciate it and enjoyed it very much. So I believe that is all, with the exception of the last bit. I want to do a little technique section. And today, since we're talking about design, I wanted to briefly talk about the two most important elements when you are choosing a sweater to knit for yourself and choosing what size to make. So I got thinking about this because of I believe it was the Knit Girls I was watching, and they were talking about Amy Herzog's fit to flatter patterns. I will link to those in the show notes, because if you have constantly been frustrated with knitting sweaters, I would strongly recommend that your next sweater pattern be one of hers. Because she does an excellent job of walking you through how to measure yourself, how to choose a size, how to choose a sweater design that suits your body type. She's an excellent designer. And one of the things that she points out that I think is a really good tip that not a lot of people realize is that the best place to measure yourself for bust size, this is Well, this would work also for men, but I think it's more essential for women. When you measure for bust size, do not measure around the fullest part of your bust. You measure right under your armpits, right here. It's a smaller measurement. And this is not true for all patterns. Some patterns are written with full bust in mind. But I think it is a reasonable assumption, unless the designer says otherwise, that the size that is going to fit you is the one that is written for this bust measurement, not down over the girls, if you know what I'm saying. There is, for some of us, there are multiple inches of difference between those two measurements. Why this matters is because when designers are writing patterns, they are basing it on a bust measurement that is tied to a shoulder measurement. If your sweater does not fit up here, it will look terrible. This shoulder measurement is the essential, really the number one essential place where your sweater needs to fit. And this measurement is tied to this measurement. Not this one. It's a good thing the camera is not pointing. You know what I'm saying. So measure here. I'm a 40 here. I'm a 44 here. Big difference. So I need to be, if I'm knitting a sweater that has a 42 inch, or if I'm knitting a sweater that is supposed to be worn with 2 inches of positive ease, and I measure 40 inches here, I should be knitting the 42 inch size. Not the 46 inch size. So that's number one. Number two, the second essential measurement is around your upper arm. People's upper arm measurements vary widely. And unfortunately, as a designer, you've got to just kind of design to the invisible middle, right? The average person, whoever that is. You've got to knit to the standard measurements. And that may not be you. It's certainly often not me. My arms are bigger around than they are supposed to be for my size. So do check. A good sweater pattern should have a schematic that tells you how big around the sleeve is in the finished garment. It should be a little, well, I'm trying to think of how to say this in the clearest way possible. The ease on that sleeve should be about half the ease of the bust. And this works for men's sweaters too. So if we go back to that example of a two inches positive ease on your sweater, there should be about that sleeve should be about an inch bigger than your actual upper arm circumference in order to, you know, to look like it fits properly. So you may need to make some adjustments, and that's a topic that's more than I can discuss in a single podcast. But if you've got fit on both of those things, if the shoulders are the right length, if the bust fits right here, and if the upper arm is the right measurement, then you've got a sweater that should suit you. As long as the shape is a good shape for you. I know there's so many variables, aren't there? On that note of confidence, I will wish you a Merry Christmas if that is your holiday of choice, and a Happy New Year to all of you. I will see you again in the new year. Bye. Oh, I'm Dark Metternitz online everywhere, and you can find me at Dark Metternitz.